It's my honor to welcome a man who truly exemplifies the optimism and leadership that President Reagan embodied. Governor Scott Walker was raised with a heart for public service, patriotism, and hard work. He moved to the small town of Delavan, Wisconsin when he was in third grade. There, his father was a minister and his mother worked part-time as a bookkeeper and secretary. Governor Walker was active in school, sports, church, scouts, and American Legion's Badger Boys State and Boys Nation programs. In June 1993, Governor Walker was elected to the State Assembly, where he helped lead the way on welfare reform, public safety, and educational opportunities. In 2002, he was elected to the Milwaukee County Executive Office. In this position, Governor Walker worked to reform the scandal-ridden county government and faithfully kept his promise to spend taxpayer money as if it were his own. In 2008, he won re-election with nearly 60% of the vote. In 2010, Governor Walker was elected the 45th governor of Wisconsin, inheriting a $3.6 billion budget deficit, $800 million worth of unpaid bills, and an 8% unemployment rate. He immediately implemented new reforms to renew economic revival, fiscal order, and government accountability in Wisconsin. Governor Walker became the first governor in American history to survive a recall election in 2012, and was re-elected in 2014 and sworn into a second term in 2015. He serves on the boards of Students for Life Action, American Federation for Children, and the Center for State-Led National Debt Solutions. Please join me in welcoming Young America's Foundation President, Governor Scott Walker.
Good evening. Good evening. Try it again. You've eaten so much. Good evening. Let's try it again. Good evening. Well, good to see all of you. Good to be up with so many of you up at the Reagan Ranch earlier today. We'll talk about that in a moment, and we'll take some questions here at the end. But I want to tell you a story. When I was a kid, probably you, any of you have got younger siblings. It wouldn't be your age. It would be a few years before that. When I was literally just a kid, I remember we used to tie, my brother, who's 3 years younger than I, we would tie a yellow ribbon around the big oak tree in front of our house. And we put it up there for 444 days. And the reason it was up there was during those 444 days, so more than a year, 52 Americans were held hostage in Iran. Started in 1978, lasted all the way through the very day that Ronald Reagan took office as the 40th president of the United States. And for us, that was bad enough, but it was particularly hit home in our community, in our neighborhood, small little town I lived in. Because one of those hostages was a 20-year-old Marine by the name of Kevin Hermaning, who was from Oak Creek, Wisconsin. Oak Creek was just a little bit down the ways from where we grew up at the time. And so for all of us kids who otherwise were just playing, you know, playing all sorts of crazy games out on the block, you know, waiting till the end of the day in the summer when our moms or dads would, you know, blow a whistle and tell us to come on home, we were carefree, except during that time it really hit home. Because Kevin Hermaning, that Marine, was one of the hostages, and he literally had just shown up there. Talk about bad luck. He just was assigned there shortly before the Iranians took those Americans hostage, and he was there, again, more than a year. Now, Kevin's still a friend of mine. He lives in north central Wisconsin. He's a few years older than I am. Like I said, I was just a kid. But I tell you that because I think back to those late 1970s, certainly when it came to the hostages, but in a whole assortment of ways, things were pretty down and out. In fact, Jimmy Carter and others at the time talked about the nation being in a malaise, and it wasn't just because of the hostages. Although it is interesting that literally minutes after Ronald Reagan took the oath of office, the Iranians let the hostages go. I don't think they were lacking in understanding. They knew that there was a new sheriff in town and that Ronald Reagan meant business when it came to his actions, not only here within the country, but around the world. At the time, though, growing up in the 70s and even before that, if you think about not just the Iranian hostage, but really from the end of World War II until that piece of the Berlin Wall that you saw when you walked in the door, about the time that came down and you saw the fall of communism, not just there in Germany, in the Eastern Germany bloc, but you saw it eventually in the Soviet Union and all throughout the old Soviet Union itself. From the point of the end of the World War, World War II, until that time, we were living in what was called a Cold War. And for a lot of us, particularly when you're a kid, the big worry at that time was, some people called it nuclear proliferation, mutually assured destruction, but a lot of young people were worried. In fact, I think early on in the Cold War, there were even some of these ridiculous exercises we would do at school and others before us would do, where just like you might do today at your high school, if you live in an area where there's tornadoes, you know, they might have you go out into the hall or get under a desk or do things like that. They would do that during the Cold War in preparation for nuclear weapons being used on your community or state, which, like, would do absolutely nothing if you were hiding under your desk. But somehow it made people feel well. And there were other places where they actually had shelters. You may still see signs sometimes in schools and other public buildings where it talked about fallout shelters, places where people would go. But there was all this tension built up and all this concern. And it was all across America, but particularly for young people at the time. And the reason I tell you all that is that changed, not just with the hostages being free, but Ronald Reagan changed. You saw a little bit of it in some of the previews of that movie about Reagan, just some snippets of that. But Ronald Reagan, when he took office in 81, it's hard to believe this, but Soviet-style communism, for many in this country and around the world, was viewed almost as successful as American traditional-style capitalism. There was a real debate as to what was going to happen in the world and which would be up on the top in terms of a superpower. Ronald Reagan, 49 years ago this month, in March of that second year he had in office, he literally talked about the Soviet Union, which is now, you know, where Putin's at. Russia was the core of that. So Russians have a long history, far predating the Federation of Russia right now. But he called the Soviet Union at that time the evil empire. And it may seem pretty obvious now, but back then, the media and a lot of his critics in politics were saying this was outrageous. It was over the top. It was dangerous. They were willing to diplomacy. His predecessor, Jimmy Carter, and the people who worked in his administration kind of were into this appeasement, this idea of, well, if you just leave people alone, they won't do anything bad. And what we saw was just the opposite took place. That without a sense of strength, Ronald Reagan repeated the phrase over and over again, peace through strength, but it really worked. If you look at the end of that decade, the 1980s, when the Berlin Wall came down, the fall of communism and the old Soviet bloc countries throughout Eastern Europe, when you saw that happening, we won the Cold War without ever firing a shot. Ronald Reagan saw fit. He saw the problems that we had, just like a few years ago, Donald Trump did some of the same things after some of the neglect of the United States military under Barack Obama and past leaders. Ronald Reagan rebuilt the military. He put significant resources and investment into rebuilding the military, giving them new tools, new weapons, new training. He had an aggressive stance with the Soviet Union, not just calling them the evil empire. He literally talked about one time when a reporter asked what his strategy was. He said, it's simple. We win, they lose. It was that simple. And so he goes, oh, you know, that's just an actor reading off some lines. No, this was something he truly believed in. If you had a chance coming in here, you know, by the Berlin Wall, there's that great video exhibit. It lasts about 4 or 5 minutes. But it really shows you that his battles with communism started well before he was president, not just in that iconic Brandenburg Gate speech at the Berlin Wall, even before the time he was governor. But really in his earliest days and his interactions part of the Screen Actors Guild, he read up and could understand the problems with communism as you saw around the world, and it had a true impact. And so he was committed to pushing back. He knew they were the evil empire. He knew that we had to win and they had to lose for us to be successful going forward. You get all sorts of great tips for books along the way. If you're interested in this topic, I tell you there's a wonderful book I read years ago by someone who's a part of the team at Reykjavik. That was in Iceland, when they had one of the summits between Mikhail Gorbachev, the leader of the Soviet Union at the time, and President Reagan. And it's called Reagan at Reykjavik. And there was enormous pressure. All the media, the TV news anchors, all the others covering it had put all this pressure. They couldn't walk away without a deal. They absolutely had to get it. And at that gathering, at that summit, President Reagan had clearly prepared. In fact, last summer, we had Bud McFarland speak at a Reagan forum in Washington, D.C., and Bud had been the national security advisor for Reagan during that time frame, and I remember asking him a few years ago, about any great stories he had, and he said, oh, I don't want to ramble on. I said, no, I'm absolutely intrigued and interested by this. And he told me, it's kind of like there's some papers up here, he said that McFarland and the team at the National Security Council had put together a thick packet on Gorbachev going into that summit. And the president took it with him up to the ranch where you saw it today, and people think, okay, he's just out clearing brush and riding horses, and he enjoyed doing that. Great way to clear his mind. But this thick packet that they had, so it was interesting. When he came back after being at the ranch and they were sitting down to talk about it, it was all crumpled up. It had notes all over it. It was torn a little bit along the way, and he gave a similar packet to then Vice President Bush, and it came back looking almost exactly the same way. The media at the time would have told you it was the other way around. They would have told you that Reagan didn't care about the details, that Bush had this extraordinary record in history, and that he would have been the one looking into it. But Reagan wanted to be prepared for that. He knew that he had to know everything he could about the Soviet economy, about what Gorbachev would think, and then going into that, for him, one of the most important components was he invested in a program called the Strategic Defense Initiative, SDI. His critics called it Star Wars. But I don't know how many of you remember last year, but when there was Hamas and some of the other terrorists were shooting missiles into Israel, there was this amazing picture in the middle of the night that they took where you could see in the black of dark, these missiles were coming in about to go and attack sites in the state of Israel. And what happened? They were all exploded in the air. Why was it? It's called the Iron Dome. The Iron Dome, it's kept. It was, you know, one of the great champions of that was Prime Minister Netanyahu, but it's something they continue to have today. Where did they get that from? That was from the Strategic Defense Initiative, SDI. That was something that Reagan said at that meeting at Reykjavik. He made it clear that not only did he have to have that as part of any deal going forward, he even offered it to the people of the Soviet Union. He said, we should all be safe. His goal wasn't to overpower one or the other. It wasn't to take over foreign countries. It was to provide peace through strength. And he walked away from that gathering, even though all the media, all the hype, all the many of the politicians in Washington gave him all sorts of grief for doing it. He was willing to stand his ground. And what happened? He knew that if we continued to put the pressure on, the Soviet economy under communism wouldn't be able to stand. And that's exactly what happened. In fact, to this day, there are many people who back then were very much nationalists. People like those in the KGB and others. Ironically, one of those young people at that time was Vladimir Putin, who didn't like the idea that Gorbachev caved in, but they couldn't financially sustain it. They were at a point where, a breaking point, where our economy and our ability to support our defense of our nation and those seeking freedom around the world surpassed that of the old Soviet Union. That's where the wall came down. That's where you saw the collapse of communism. That's where you saw a fundamental change. And because of that, you saw one of the longest sustained periods of peace, not only for the United States, but throughout the world, because of the peace dividend that came from that vigilance that Ronald Reagan had. Now, growing up during that era, second term he had, I was in high school, so I was about your age. I always say that Ronald Reagan probably had more impact on me than any other adult in my life other than my parents. I'm not just a conservative or even a Republican because of him. I'm an optimist. One of the great things I loved about President Reagan was his optimism. He's a happy warrior. And if you take nothing away from my comments tonight, be that. Be a happy warrior. And it's part of the reason why I'm telling you about not only what happened on the side with the Soviet Union and with the Iranian hostages, but I want to add one more quick thing and then we'll open up some questions. The times in the late 70s, before Ronald Reagan took office, weren't just difficult times because of the hostages, because of the Cold War, because of all the other pressures. They were really challenging times when it came to the economy. In many ways, similar to what we have today. Back then, we called it stagflation. It was a combination of really high inflation, which we can relate to these days. It drives up the cost of fuel, drives up the cost of food, it drives up the cost of housing. And at the same time, you had, as if that wasn't bad enough, you had a really bad economy, so this awful economic growth and opportunity. There's a video on the floor above us, right by the table where President Reagan signed the largest tax cut in American history. And in that little video clip, there's one of the lines I loved from the 1980 campaign. Again, I was just a kid in middle school. But he said, Recession is when your neighbor's out of work. A depression is when you're out of work. And a recovery is when Jimmy Carter's out of work. But there was a lot of truth to that. You know, he used humor all throughout his career, but it was to make a point. And the point was that the policies that Jimmy Carter were putting in place was making it hard for people to create jobs and opportunity. A good example I mentioned, the table up there. So August 13th, 1981, so just over 40 years ago, he signs the largest tax cut in American history. A couple of us were just up seeing it earlier tonight. Put in perspective, though, wasn't just that he was signing a tax cut. It wasn't just that it was the largest ever at that time. The rates before he signed that tax relief were 70% on the top marginal tax rate. Think about that for a minute. So if you go home and maybe your parents next week and ask you to do a job, and you say, if you go out next week and you do this for me, I'll pay you $100. Under those rates, somebody else would take $70 away from you. You'd be left with 30. It'd hardly be worth doing it, would it? You'd say, that's not fair. How can the government do it? But that's what the rates were. In fact, actually, we were talking about this earlier. If you go back even before that, 1964 tax cuts were named after John F. Kennedy, President Kennedy. Sadly, he tragically was shot and killed in 1963. But it was his tax cut idea, which today would make him not a Democrat. He would clearly be a Reagan-type Republican. But those tax cuts actually lowered the marginal tax rate to the high end that were about 90%, down to 70%. And then Reagan moved them down from there. Well, you saw this. This was like opening up the doors, you know, to, you know, you could have a barriers on a flood wall, and it's like letting the economy loose. This had unbelievable, the longest sustained economic growth in American history. And it's something not just to tell you about the past, but it's something that can happen again. We saw a bit of it in 2017 after the tax cuts that President Trump signed. We didn't have enough time to see it fully enacted along the way, but you give the American people more money. You give the American small business owner more money to invest, what do? They put it right back in the economy. They hire more people, they raise wages, they invest in technology and innovation. They do things that make the economy work. When you do things like what Joe Biden and the other radicals and liberals in Washington are talking about these days, you put more money in, particularly in the hands of the federal government, not just government. Government is bad enough, but you put it in the hands of the Washington-based federal government, where you get pennies on the dollar back. That doesn't do anything except build up this federal bureaucracy. It's what's driving inflation as we see it today. So I tell you all that you saw Reagan with the tax cuts, which, by the way, were no easy task. The United States Senate in 1980 flipped to Republican, but the House was entirely Democrat by a strong margin. He had to convince over 40 blue dog Democrats to vote for that tax cut. How did he do it? He used the bully puppet. He went out and sold it all across America. He made the case that this was necessary to get the economy going again. And there are enough people who set aside party to do the right thing. And it worked, not just in 81 with the tax cuts, but the subsequent cuts in 1986 in particular brought about the longest sustained economic growth in American history, providing a dividend that not only lasted throughout his term, into the term of his successor, former President Bush, even into Bill Clinton's time. Part of the reason why they were able to balance the budget, short-lived as it was at the federal level for a few years in the 1990s, wasn't because of things that Bill Clinton did. It was because of that leftover dividend from the Reagan years and the benefits of the tax cut and the strong economy. So anyway, the reason I tell you all that tonight is not just because I love Reagan, which I do, that's obvious. I came of age under his presidency and thought of him as that happy warrior, but to remind you and give you hope that as challenging as things are, as awful as what we see with the, yet another version of the evil empire, not only with Russia going into Ukraine, what we see with the Uyghurs and the Communist Chinese Party and the pushback and the detention camps and the awful things that they're doing, not only is it the challenges that we see with inflation driving up the cost of certainly of gas, my goodness, to see the pumps here, it's particularly shocking in California where we have such a, not only a high cost of living, but the high gas tax and everything else on top of the high inflation rates. But you see all these things happening, you might think, whoa, are we ever going to get better? And the good news is we have a roadmap how to do that. Ronald Reagan did it. He did it because he believed in the American people. I hope one of the things you saw today at the Reagan Ranch was not just a little bit about the person that he was, People often, Ed Meese, who was his attorney general, used to say, you go to the Reagan library to learn about the administration. You go to the Reagan ranch to learn about the man. And you certainly saw someone who was very frugal, very down to earth, very normal, very rational. For a guy who was a movie star and arguably one of the most important leaders of the 20th century, you didn't get any of that pretense out at the ranch, particularly in the ranch home itself. But you saw somebody who lived those ideals. But I think part of that was not only who he was, but he had this just internal belief in freedom. I particularly think that's why he loved riding on the trails. It reminded him of the untapped potential of the American people. Wide open spaces, unlimited opportunity. He believed in you. And I think not only if you talk about Reagan when you go back, but just in general, whether it's in your debate class, what's going on in the college or university in the future, whether it's on social media, it's a great reminder that the contrast to socialism and communism isn't just capitalism, market-based capitalism. It's fundamentally bigger than that. It's freedom. What we stand for is freedom. Ronald Reagan wisely said many a time that freedom is never more than one generation away from extinction. It's something that doesn't get passed on to you because of your bloodstream. It's not in your DNA. It's something you have to stand up for and fight and defend and then to pass on to you and future generations to do exactly the same thing. I was honored to be governor of the state of Wisconsin and to face some unbelievable challenges. We got remarkable things done for 8 years. But I'm so glad to be with all of you here, because as challenging as things appear to be, I am confident. I just know. And I hope you've seen it in your schools and your interaction with friends and fellow students and others along the way, that if we just get the truth out, and we're depending on you to do that, if we get the truth out, if we are happy warriors like Ronald Reagan was, if we make the case for freedom, if we stand for freedom, and we make that case and we explain it in ways that aren't just about the mind but about the heart meshed together, with stories like President Reagan did, that there's nothing we can't achieve and there's no challenges we can't overcome in this great country. So appreciate you all being here for these couple days. I know some of you have been here before. We're glad to see you back again. Others, it's your first time. It's your first conference. And we're hopeful this won't be your last, because whether it's during your time in high school or looking ahead to whatever comes next, we're counting on you to make sure that we, and you in particular, can not only live up to the ideals of freedom and liberty and justice for all, but you can pass it on to your own next generation to do the same. With that, we'll take some questions.
All right, students, y'all know the drill. There's a yellow tape line back there, so if you'll please line up behind that. And when you come up here, please remember to state your name, your school, and keep your questions brief so we can get to as many as possible.
Hello, my name is Emily Levy. I'm from Scottsdale, Arizona, and I'm homeschooled. And my question for you was, you mentioned how Ronald Reagan had the policy of peace through strength. What was the best action he took to institute that policy against Russia?
Well, two things. One more obvious, and that was building up the military. You know, if you're going to take on a bully, the bully has to know that you've got the capacity to act. Now, he didn't want to act. He didn't want to engage in warfare. He didn't want to put American service members at risk, but he had to have the capacity. So rebuilding the military, not only in the number, but the size, the equipment, the power, was certainly important. I think the other thing is seeing your willingness to follow through. And this is where it might be a little surprising. I've said this before, but I believe one of the most significant things he did to influence the Soviet leaders as to how serious he was something he did that many would consider to be domestic policy. In August of 1981, right about the time he signed the tax cuts, there was a federal public employees union by the name of PATCO. They were the air traffic controllers. A lot of people in the media mistakenly think this was retribution somehow politically. PATCO actually endorsed Ronald Reagan in the primaries. So he had nothing to do with unions or anything else. It had everything to do with right and wrong. Federal employees, like most state employees and local employees across the nation, are prohibited by law from federal statute from striking for obvious reasons. You don't want firefighters, police officers, air traffic controllers striking. But they got cocky because they had endorsed Ronald Reagan, he won, they thought they could ask for anything. He and his administration thought they deserved a reasonable increase from what they had before, but not what they were asking for. And so they walked off the job. He stood in the Rose Garden with members of his cabinet and said, you have 48 hours to show up for work or you'll be terminated and you'll never work in the federal government again. Out of over 13,000 air traffic controllers, only about 1,200 showed up. He kept his word, fired every single one of them. First couple days, there were about 7,000 flights that were canceled across the nation. Could have been horrible. Could have been an absolute catastrophe. But he wasn't worried about the political ramifications. He was determined to stand up for what was right, and it was against the law. From the Dewey, he gave them fair warning, and they didn't act. Not only was that a strong domestic policy, to this day, if you go back and read some of the accounts, including former Speaker Tip O'Neill, who was in the Kremlin not long after that, they said that that's one of the key moments when they took note and said, this guy means business. We're not messing around with him. And so I would just take that a step further, not just with Reagan or even a president, but tell you in your own lives, who you associate with, what you talk about, the things you chose to hone in, those are things that not only influence you in that moment, they'll have a larger influence on how people view you and how you're shaped for the rest of your life. Ronald Reagan, all throughout his career, even back in Dixon, chose to surround himself with positive people who gave him positive messages and kept him on the straight and narrow, and it went a long, long way. And that was certainly true when it came to those air traffic controllers.
All right, thank you so much.
Hello, I'm Jordan DeBonapala. I go to San Antonio Christian School down in Texas. And I was wondering if there was a specific moment or event in history that inspired you to begin your dive into politics and how that affects how you think today.
First off, nice bow tie. I like that.
Thank you.
Looking sharp there, looking dapper. I don't know if it's a specific moment. For me, it was a series. Again, I came of age under Reagan. So I saw the combination of when I saw those hostages, one of whom I was familiar with being from Wisconsin, shortly after, it wasn't long after that the president was shot, and just the way that he handled that, the grace, even as he often did throughout his career, using humor as a way of comforting the nation, and then seeing not long after that, Pope John Paul II, there was a failed assassination attempt against him as well. And you can look at that moment, not so much for me, but watching it, and see that the two of them in particular had this, I think this almost divinely inspired inspiration to take on communism. The Pope, of course, had been from his homeland was Poland, which was a part of the communist bloc at that time. So I think seeing all that, and then you know, even just things that weren't particularly policy driven, the way that he comforted America after the space shuttle went down. I just think there was an incredible level of comfort in this country, that this was a leader we could trust, who was straightforward with us, who really bought back that sense of pride in America. And it wasn't based on party solely. It was based on believing in core American principles.
Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Walker Peterson.
I like that first one.
I'm from Westlake Village, California. And I just wanted to ask, because I remember you bringing up the fact that you remember when they had the fallout drills. Do you like fully remember that as a kid?
No, I remember people talking about those. Most of those were, the fallout shelters were 50s into the 60s. We still had fallout shelter signs and that, but they were similar to the ones that we did later as kids when we had tornado drills and things like that. But they were remnants of that. And the thing that we did talk the most about were this phrase that was repeated over and over again called mutually assured destruction, which was this idea that the United States and the Soviet Union had so many missiles that if one pushed it, the other would go off, and if the other pushed it, the other would go off, and that they were all timed and set so that it would set off this nuclear war that would lead to this nuclear holocaust. And it was incredibly frightening, particularly for kids at that time. But I'm sorry, that wasn't probably solely your question, but was there more to it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thanks.
I'm sorry, what?
No, was there more to it than just you asking about the,
I have a bit of a follow-up.
Oh, sure, go ahead, please.
Do you think that same fear is going to start up again of a nuclear winter?
Well, I think it's a problem not only with Russia. I think, again, this is my personal opinion. I think not only with Russia, I think you see that with North Korea. I think it's a foolhardy deal to give Iran any capacity to have a nuclear weapon, because their original intent will be to take out and destroy Israel, our strongest ally in the Middle East. But I think it's only a matter of time when you give tyrants capacity to have nuclear weapon access, they'll eventually use it against other free, freedom-loving countries like ours. And I think, you know, as much as peace through strength worked for Reagan, we're seeing the opposite now. Weakness opens the door. Weakness welcomes evil. Joe Biden, I think you would actually have to try to screw up Afghanistan more than Joe Biden did. I've been to Bagram. I've been to the Capitol. I've been to the embassy. I've been with service members there. I saw the array that they had there. Don't believe for one second the military told him to draw down troops at Bagram, the air base in Afghanistan. What they told him was, if you're going to force us to reduce the numbers to this level, we can't fortify both the air base at Bagram and the embassy in the Capitol. That's not telling him to do that. That was purely a political judgment to try and dry it out by August 31st. It's a horrible example. It not just screwed things up. It didn't just leave Americans vulnerable in Afghanistan. It didn't just cut and dry our allies who'd helped work with the military over many, many years in the past. I think, and it's not just me thinking it, Robert Gates, who was Secretary of Defense under both a Republican and a Democrat president, said that the weakness of America earlier this year is opening the door to aggression from both Putin in Russia and Xi Jinping in China. And I think he's exactly right. The only distinction I had with him, with what Secretary Gates said, is I don't think America's weak. I think the current occupant of the White House is weak. I think the American people are strong, and we understand there are better ways we can show peace through strength than what we're getting out of the current occupant. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Daniel Donner, homeschooled in Washington, and I just have a quick question.
Yeah, Daniel.
In your speech, you mentioned that the tax cuts that Reagan initiated carried on into Bush's presidency. However, I was reading a book, and it mentioned that in Bush's presidency, he was actually forced to raise taxes because of Reagan's tax cut. So if Reagan's tax cut had caused such a big benefit, then why was Bush forced to raise the taxes?
Well, he wasn't. It was one of the worst political decisions in the history of American politics. He said at the 1988 convention, "Read my lips, no new taxes." And then he bought into the crap of Tom Foley and the House Democrats, who told him that he had to raise taxes in order to deal with the deficit. Two parts. One, if you actually look, and I proved it to be true in Wisconsin, as did Reagan under his administration. When you cut taxes, if you do it aggressively enough and it has a positive impact on the economy and investment, you actually see revenues go up. Using an interesting analogy, I go to Kohl's a lot because they're from Wisconsin, they're nearby, but you could go to any retailer. I learned a long time ago, if you go to Kohl's, I never buy anything at the price it's listed at, because there's always a sale at Kohl's department stores, right? And if you're really paying attention, it's not just the markdown on a shirt or whatever you're buying. It's usually a markdown, and then if you look at your app or your mailer, it'll say 15, 20, 30% off, and if you got sometimes to an area, I have some Kohl's cash, and we'll use that. Next thing you know, they're practically paying us to buy the shirt. Not quite exactly, but retail, why do retail outlets have so many sales? Volume. They could charge you full price for that product, and a few of us could afford it, or they could lower the price and expand the number of people who can actually afford to buy it. So they don't make as much per product, but they make more because they sell more volume. That's what tax cuts do. Did it under Reagan. The deficits came about because various speakers, starting with Tip O'Neill, Foley, Wright, and others, spent more than the new revenue was brought in to the federal government during those tax cuts. In my case, we cut taxes $13 billion in Wisconsin and 8 consecutive years of a surplus. Why? Because more revenue came in during that time. What happened with Bush is he bought into this lie that on top of all their spending, that somehow they needed to raise taxes to get more revenue to buy down the deficit. The irony was the taxes they raised them on were on luxury items. Boats, cars, certain other things along the way. And what happened? What did people with wealth who could buy them do? They bought them somewhere else. They bought them in the, you know, outside of the country. And so what happened? They later had to pull that tax and creep back because it was actually costing them money because people weren't buying them those luxury items at all out there. So it was both a politically bad move, but economically, it actually showed that just the opposite happened to what they projected along the way. And one of the challenges, I remember our son Matthew's 27, when he was your age, he was a senior at Wauwatosa East High School. Had a great teacher, but she had a textbook that made basically that same argument that Reagan's tax cuts brought about the deficits of the 80s, but they didn't. It may be in your packet, but one of the books that's on the bookshelf out here, Dinesh D'Souza, does a great job of explaining that in his book about Reagan. So I just say do this as a follow-up to that. Bush actually would have had a second term if he had not raised taxes. He was in the 90s in approval rating after the war in Iraq had gone through successfully in a matter of days and could have rode that all the way through the 92 election. But because he broke his promise, a guy named Ross Perot got in the race, mucked things up, and Bill Clinton, who, by the way, never got a majority of the vote, the popular vote, so you hear all this crap from the left about that. Bill Clinton, in both of his elections, failed to get 50% of the popular vote, was elected president of the United States. But the one part about what I would say is the economic recovery that started under Reagan continued under Bush and even into Clinton, despite the fact that Bush made that really poor decision to raise taxes.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Esther Cooksanko, and I'm homeschooled out of Fresno, California. So my question is for you, in your opinion, what would Reagan's response be to the war that's going on in Ukraine and Russia, and would it be different from what the Biden administration is doing right now, and how?
Yes. It'd be 100% different. I'd say this. It would never start in the first place. And not just Reagan. I mean, let's be clear. Putin was aiming to go further in Ukraine under Obama. Why did he back down? Because he didn't know what the hell Donald Trump was going to do. And so for 4 years, if anybody has any doubt, it would not only have not happened under Reagan, it didn't happen under Trump. Why did he go there? Because weakness welcomes evil. This is not just true in foreign policy. Think about when you were younger, maybe, think about bullies on the playground. You know, when somebody stands up to them, they fall apart. And it doesn't mean you have to go pick fights with folks, but that's just a common principle, that most bullies are frauds. Most are bullies are just fearful, but nobody stands up to them. And so Reagan did that. Trump did it differently. Obviously, it's a different style, different style points there. But it was the same principle, that if you build up your military and if people are not certain what you're going to do next, they're likely not to test you out. Conversely, if you go back and read history, Joe Biden's the closest thing I can see to Neville Chamberlain. Chamberlain was an appeaser. He led to the appeasement that, you know, when Adolf Hitler went into the old Czech, what's now the Czech Republic, and he made similar claims that they're making to Ukraine about German-speaking people in that country, in that region. Chamberlain and the others appeased him right down to Vienna, which is ironic because Joe Biden, a few years ago when he was vice president, was in Vienna and was part of the reset process with Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden and others saying they're resetting relations with Russia, which is all about appeasement. If you appease those who invoke evil, similarly, we should be just as outraged, we're not, as a country or the world, but just as outraged against Xi Jinping and what they've done to the Uyghurs and what they're likely, unfortunately, to do with Taiwan. I think they're going to watch closely. And if there's not retribution for Russia over the long haul, I would expect that China will go into Taiwan because they've made claims for that territory or for that country for decades before all this. But bottom line is Reagan wouldn't have allowed this to happen in the first place because they would have never risked taking that chance.
Thank you.
Well,
Okay. You just grab it. It's fine.
Hi, my name is Claire Beckley. I go to Aquinas High School in San Bernardino. My question is, you mentioned a lot about Reagan's optimism. What else did you like about him?
Well, a combination of not just optimism. Like I said, he was a happy warrior. I thought he, and you see this certainly at the home, if you ever get a chance, if you ever go to any of our conferences, the Reagan Boyhood Home in Dixon, you'll find that the things he grew up on as a kid stayed constant with him all throughout his life. One of the books on the bookshelf is called That You Print or You Dell. It's a book his mother had him and his brother read. It's part of why he decided to be baptized about three blocks down the way in Dixon. It's still on his bookshelf. You know, so the very last days he was there at the ranch, I had an influence on his life. He, besides talking about his relationship with his wife, Nancy, that you heard about in the little clip there about the movie, you ask him about, beyond just that, what one of his proudest, most significant accomplishments would be. It wasn't the fall of communism, very important. It wasn't tax cuts. He'd tell you, going back to his days on the Rock River, that he saved 77 lives as a lifeguard. Those were things that he, things that were valuable to him along the way, that stayed, all throughout his life. The other thing I'll just say in the larger context, and it fits in with all of you here and what many of you are facing in your schools and certainly facing college and university, is, there's this big push to bring back Marxism, communism, socialism. It's really Marxism. If you've watched the last couple of years, the BLM organizers, this isn't hyperbole. They've flat out said publicly, it's on video, you can YouTube it, that all three of them were Marxist organizers. And if you look in the past, long before you were born, in some cases even before your parents were born, Marxism, there were people attempting to push that here in the United States. And why did it fail? Because we don't have a class-based society. Ronald Reagan's story is a classic example of that. Ronald Reagan was not just president, arguably the most significant president, if not world leader, of the 20th century, at least the latter half. He was a guy who grew up in five different homes in Dixon, none of which his family owned, the son of an alcoholic who was in and out of work, who went from this small town to basically a community college, not an Ivy League school, who worked at two different radio stations on air, reading the sports and doing other things along the way, goes as a B actor, so not even the premier actors, but kind of a subtext one, which we don't have anymore, didn't even have when I was a kid, but a B actor, but gets involved, gets engaged, reads. If you don't learn anything else about it, Reagan, look how much he read, how much he absorbed, and then he'd write and learn along the way and stay true to who he was along that path. And he became not only a governor and a president, but really didn't shift. He was so centered in who he was and where he wanted to go and where he wanted to take this country. And so I think that's just really powerful, because these days I think the trend you see with BLM and others is that they're trying to bring back Marxism, but not based solely on economic differences, but based on race and sex and gender. And so when people tell you in society, maybe even in your schools, that conservatives are divisive, you should push back and say the opposite is true. Radicals on the left are the divisive ones. They disagree with it. It doesn't matter what the topic is. They want to tell you that you're racist, you're sexist, you're transphobic, whatever the issue is, doesn't matter. Those are the things they'll throw at you. Our counter, taking a page out of Reagan, needs to be not to call them our own names, but rather to say, you know what? We don't care whether you're young or old. We don't care if you're black or white, rich or poor. We don't care whether you're born here or legally came here from somewhere else. We want every person in this country to have access to the same freedoms and the same opportunities that we inherited from our parents and our grandparents. I think that's a powerful, powerful message, and it's certainly one that I took out of watching the life of President Reagan along the way. So thanks.
Hello, my name is Ariana Lynch. I attend Arrowhead High School out of Wisconsin. And coming out of the Wisconsin legislature, Governor Walker, do you observe any parallels between the aspiring Clayfish administration and the Reagan administration, if any, having worked very close with her, of course.
Sure. Well, in my case, Rebecca Clayfish was my lieutenant governor, did a fabulous job when she was in office, and you know, part of our team, not just her and I, but the others were involved in our team. You know, we tried to have a clear focus. Even you may know, growing up in Wisconsin, although hopefully 10, 11 years ago, hopefully you weren't worried about this too much at that time. But at the time in Wisconsin in 2011, you know, we had not just a few hundred, we had about 100,000 protesters occupy our Capitol. They went after Tonet and I and our family. They went after our administration. They went after Rebecca Clayfish. They went after members of the state legislature. And, you know, it was for about a month, and there were death threats and everything else. But we knew, you know, who we were, like Reagan, where we wanted to go, what we needed to do. We were grounded. And then I remember early on, after those first couple days of the protest and the horrible pushback and the threats along the way, one of the most important things that at least I thought back to was remembering how Reagan would go out, use the bully pulpit, go around the country. In our case, we went around the state. I went out there, Lieutenant Governor Clayfish went around and others did, and we made the case that not only got us through those early days, but became the first governor and first lieutenant governor in the history of the nation to win a recall election, in our case, actually with more votes than we did the first time. So, great question.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay.
This will be our last question, Governor.
Great, thanks.
Hi, I'm Alexandra Lang. I go to Chesterton Academy of Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Nice.
My question for you is, how do you balance your life politically and spiritually?
Well, it's first off, great question. I'll come back to it, but I should say thanks to all of you for asking questions. And I know I heard some of the questions earlier from other speakers and other parts of the program. So we really appreciate you all being here. On that one, it actually ties in well with the previous question. Because people say, you know, with all the death threats and the pushback and the riots and the protests that were going on, you know, how did you deal with it? I said, just on a personal level, I try to start in my day the same way, on my knees. If I'm, you know, trying to, you know, thank God for another day, how am I going to get through it, where should I be focused, and then do the same at the end of the day, it's incredibly cleansing to take so much of that worry and stress out of the way. It doesn't completely eliminate it, but it helps deal with it. And what I found was true, not just for me doing that, but being open to others who were doing that. I found it was amazing in the particular first days as we got out of the Capitol, got out of the dome, traveled the state. And I would find, I remember the first time it happened, it was this big, like 6'7" guy at a factory, covered in, you know, grease and dirt and muck on. He sees me, he comes off of his machine. I think he was a machinist. And I thought, oh man, I'm going to get it. This guy's upset with me. He's bought into all the attacks and the whole bit. And he comes up and he points his finger in my chest. I thought, here it is. And he says, Governor, I just want you to know that me and my family pray for you every night. And we constantly found that all throughout the places we went to. I remember a similar story. A woman who was the floor manager on a TV station in Green Bay on the morning show. I was up doing one of the TV shows. And she came down, bent down, I was seated, and she came down to hook up the mic that was going to go on my lapel, and she whispered that, she said, I just want you to know that every night my three girls and I get on our knees and we pray for you and your family. And it got to the point, I did it then, I still do now when people tell me they pray for us, is I reach out and touch them. It might be just their elbow, shoulder, something along the way, but I just found it was incredibly powerful. Again, as a personal side of that, I find meaning in that because I think, you know, you look back in the Bible, there's a powerful story about a woman who was unclean for 12 years, and she heard that Christ was coming through an open courtyard, and she ran out there, even though it was totally against all the rules, and she touched the end of his cloak, and he turned, and he said, who touched me? He could feel her. He knew. And he immediately didn't just say, hey, he actually turned and said, my daughter, your sins have healed you. And she was often healed and saved from all that. And I just think of that. That's why it's weird, particularly in this COVID world, but I still touch people's shoulder, hand, or elbow who tell me they pray for me because at the height of our challenges, just being open to people around me who were lifting us up in prayer made such an incredible difference. And I tried to do the same for folks I know, whether they're in similar positions or somewhere else in life, who just need, whether I tell them that or I just do it, those moments and glimpse of God's grace through their prayers and other support. So it goes a long way. Great question.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks, everybody. Have a good rest of the time. We appreciate you being here.